Hey everyone, Reid here. Welcome to another installment of the Video Power Rankings. Today we're covering Standard, just classic Standard, not Alchemy. Kamigawa Neon Dynasty has been out for a couple of weeks, so we're starting to get a clear picture of what the competitive metagame is looking like. Let's dive in. Coming in at number 10, we have Rakdos or Mardu Sacrifice. The key cards here are always going to be Shambling Ghast and Deadly Dispute. From there, there's a lot of customizability. Of course, a couple of really appealing cards from the new set are Oni Cult Anvil and Experimental Synthesizer. So you could go in that direction with Artifact Sacrifice, sometimes tapping into the Blood Token synergies. But as mentioned, there's a huge range of ways you can build this, all the way from aggressive low curve decks that are targeting your opponent's life total, all the way to more controlling decks like Blood on the Snow, black-based control deck, just tapping into red for a select few cards. At number 9, we have Gruul, sometimes Naya, but the main decks that I'm talking about here are either Werewolf Tribal or just a non-tribal Gruul beatdown deck. In both cases, you have a deck that was a pretty big winner from the banning of Faceless Haven, Allrun's Epiphany, Divide by Zero, and a deck that even picked up some new tools with Kamigawa Neon Dynasty. In any case, these decks play the hardest hitting threats possible. If your opponent ever misses a beat, they're pretty much just dead. They're not gonna be able to survive your early rush. And that's especially true if you're playing Werewolves and your opponent misses a play on an early turn, the game's basically over on the spot. At number 8, we have Blue-White Azorius Control. White, I think, became an especially good pairing for blue control decks because of Kamigawa Neon Dynasty really rounding out the removal suite. Very excited about Igonjo, Seat of the Empire. That's like the perfect deck for, or perfect card for an Azorius Control deck, in that it can either be untapped reliable mana, or it can be a removal spell for a creature that's attacking you or one of your planeswalkers, insurance against haste creatures, clean up the mess after you've wiped the board with a Doomscar or a Farewell. But we also have March of Otherworldly Light as a new addition from Neon Dynasty, and a huge one is the Wandering Emperor. So this is a blue-white control deck using a lot of these new white removal spells and curving all the way up to Hullbreaker Horror, which is sort of the apex predator of Standard right now. Number 7, we have Mono Green. Not gonna be a huge surprise here. This deck has existed in a pretty similar form for actually a couple full like iterations of Standard, but it remains extremely powerful. Werewolf Pack Leader, Old Growth Troll, Blizzard Brawl. These are just some of the most efficient and punishing cards you can have, especially that Blizzard Brawl being a one mana removal spell that lets you attack with impunity into opposing blockers and kill your opponent's best threat on a turn that you're usually double spelling. That could be a huge tempo swing. Coming in at number 6, we have Blue White or Esper Midrange. So another archetype with sort of blurry lines where there's a lot of customizability in what you're doing, but generally these decks are going to want to play utility creatures. Think, you know, cards with Flash, Skyclave Apparition, Brutal Cathar, stuff like that, and disruptive elements, counter spells, keep your opponents on their toes and navigate the game into a race situation or otherwise some kind of scenario that your deck is better suited to winning than your opponent. Now, as we get into the top 5 decks, this is what I consider to be really the top tier of Standard right now. Browsing through events, these are the decks that just consistently showed up in top 8s, the decks that are winning events, the decks that you really want to be prepared for and have a clear game plan against if you're going to be playing Standard coming up. So at number 5, we have Mono White. So again, mostly a familiar archetype, but picked up a lot of new weapons with Neon Dynasty, and just one of the fastest, most punishing decks. Hopeful Initiate's really good right now. Wandering Emperor's really good right now. Thalia and Elite Spellbinder remain excellent ways to build disruption into the structure of your main deck. So you could do a lot worse than choosing Mono White. Number 4, we have Orzhov Control. This is what I like to call the king of the fair matchups. If you're just playing you know, bread and butter magic, trading resources, playing creatures to attack and block. Orzhov is kind of the best you can be doing. The value generation, the quality of the removal spells, Vanishing Verse and Rite of Oblivion, just so high. And Orzhov, you know, again, another archetype where you can customize it. You have really, really good sideboard options to tailor for whatever matchup you need to beat. And I expect Orzhov to continue putting up good results in Standard. At number three, we have two different versions of Jeskai, but both are really combo-esque decks, or at least blur the lines between control, midrange, and combo. So the first one is Jeskai Hinata. Hinata Dawncrowned allows you to cast spells cheaper for the number of targets they have. So if you just look at Standard's list of most powerful spells, including the ones that do have multiple targets, you come up with Magma Opus. This one is just crazy, because if you can just, you can find six distinct targets for Magma Opus's ability to cost two mana and will almost always result in a game win. Other options include Lorehold Command, March of Swirling Mists. A lot of these cards happen to pair well with Goldspan Dragon 2, giving you that influx of mana. So a really nice package there in Jeskai Hinata. The other deck is what I'm calling Jeskai Treasures. So reminiscent of the old Jeskai Mutate deck, this uses Seize the Spoils, Unexpected Windfall, Goldspan Dragon to generate just unfair amounts of mana. And eventually you get to the point where you have Leer, Disciple of the Drowned. So each one of these spells that generates treasures or targets your Goldspan Dragon gives you multiple casts, digs you deeper into your library, and eventually you can win the game with Alchemist's Gambit to take another turn, or a white card whose name is escaping me that effectively storms for the number of spells that you've cast this turn and puts +1/+1 counters on your creatures. All right, the number two deck for this installment is It Dragons. A lot of similarities there between the number three Jeskai Hinata and number two Is It Dragons. In both cases, you've got Expressive Iteration, you've got Goldspan Dragon, you've got efficient options regarding burn, counterspells, and card drawing. But Is It Dragons just more like simple, no-frills approach where you are playing Goldspan Dragon, which remains one of the best threats in the format, alongside all of these efficient support cards. And the number one deck of this installment of the Video Power Rankings, it is Naya Runes. Very, very exciting new archetype from Kamigawa Neon Dynasty. So the key cards here are gonna be Jukai Naturalist, Runeforged Champion, and Showdown of the Scalds. Between Naturalist and Runeforged Champion, you have two different ways to reduce the cost of your auras, your runes. And if you have both on the battlefield, they're actually free to cast. So the idea is you have these explosive turns where you chain together three, four, five, even more spells in one turn. And you can capitalize on that by either using it on a turn where you have chapter two or chapter three of Showdown of the Scalds, or where you have Generous Visitor on the battlefield, Kami of Transience, Michiko's Reign of Truth. But anyway, this Naya Runes deck really checks all the boxes in terms of being fast, having tons of card advantage, and having this combo-esque element where even if your opponent, you know, wipes your board with Doomscar or Farewell, if you have a robust starting position, you can actually just produce like a 10-10 haste trample creature pretty easily and kill your opponent out of nowhere. So that's it for today's video power rankings. Let me know if you think there's a sleeper deck in Standard that's going to put up results and that I should consider for the next installment. Thanks, everyone.